and right today I'm 87 years old. You see, when the war was over, I was in Saigon, and I left there on the war. I was freed out of prison on the 6th of September. My birthday was the 7th, and you talk about a birthday present. And I wouldn't know where to even can't buy a can of beer.
And what year was that?
45, 1945, yeah. They put me out of the Navy in August of 47. I wanted to retire out of the Navy, but I liked it. But anyway, they shipped me to Leavenworth, Kansas, VA hospital there. And in December, that middle part of December, I guess told the nurse I should bring my damn clothes. I'm going home. And of course, we corresponded back and forth. And so went to Minnesota, 40 below zero. And on the 23rd of December, we'd married. And her birthday was Christmas Day. So she got a good present. So we got
great
an anniversary
Christmas
and a
present.
Birthday all in one time. But we raised three boys. And we lost one about 4 years ago.
I'm sorry.
48 years old, cancer. Mm. But the one big boy, he's the oldest one. And we got another boy who lives in California, works at a refinery out there.
Oh.
And he's pretty close to being retired, too. But we've got along pretty good. I've got into old cars now, and I got three of them, and I like to sell some of them. But I'm working on a 55 Chevrolet now, and just something to do. You know, we raise a big garden every year.
Going back to your younger years, how did you find yourself in the Army? Did you enlist in the Army, or were you drafted?
No, I volunteered. Let me go way back there, too. See, when I was 11 years old, I lost my mother. And with nine of us kids, and my dad remarried, and I ain't gonna tell you the rest of what I thought of her, but anyway, I stayed home with her, with the dad till I was 14. I was 11 then, but when I was 14, I just left home. And the teacher in school knew what we was putting up with at home, so she found me a place to live and work on the truck gardens. So from there on till 1940, I worked different farmers and lived with them, and they took care of me pretty well.
And where was this?
Right there in Kansas City, in Shawnee and Muncie and three or four different places. But I stayed there. I tried to get in the Navy when I was 17, but I had bad feet and I had a bad heart. But 1940, when I went over there again, I was in perfect shape. So they needed men at the time. But I really wanted to stay in the Navy and retire. I liked it. When I shipped out, I went to Great Lakes and had my boot training, you know, and then I went to California, I was in San Diego for a while, and then I went to Long Beach, and I got on a battleship and rode to Pearl Harbor. Now I got on the USS Yorktown, which is an aircraft carrier. And I was three decks below the waterline, and I didn't like that too well. But, you know, I was also in a refueling on the airplanes. And everybody had a different job, had a different colored cap over the ear flaps, you know. And I had a red one. Well, I kept it with me, you know, when I left Yorktown and I went to Houston. Well, I got on to Houston, I was on a 5-inch gun. So I sewed paddings in there for the noise, you know. And I had it on my head when I left the ship, when the Houston got sunk. And I always figured if I keep that cap on, nothing ever happened to me. And I still got that cap. I brought two things back with me, my keys to my locker on the ship and that red cap. And then my keys to the locker is in a museum in Texas right now.
Tell me where you were when Pearl Harbor was attacked.
Well, I was in Iloilo, Cebu in the Philippines when Pearl Harbor got hit.
How did you find out about it, and what was? Can you explain to me your reaction and that of your shipmates?
It, you know, how in the hell them people get in there? You know, I mean, they're supposed to have aircraft circling and spy planes and stuff like that, but it was hard to believe, and to tell what was happening, sinking all them ships and everything, and killing so many people, I couldn't believe that. But there's we heard about it the next day, I think. But we stayed there 3 days. She go back a little further. In January, December the 1st, Admiral Hart, which is in charge of the Asiatic Fleet, he told everybody in Manila and Pearl Harbor to get out of there by the 1st of December. Well, we did. We cleared the harbor in Manila. Everything would float. Well, you see what happened in Pearl Harbor. Well, so we went south into Cebu, and Manila got blowed hell out of it, same day as Pearl Harbor did, and we was out of there. Well, anyway, we was in Cebu 3 days after it started, and we waited for the admiral to come down and give us further orders. Well, he did. And, so then we went to convoy and stuff from the Philippines down to Java and Australia and Sumatra, stuff that they could use. But we were under a lot of air raids. And on February the 4th, 43, must have been 44. And we took one bomb. It killed 49 men on the ship and knocked out our rear turret. Well, a lot of them men were killed by concussion below deck. But I was up on my gun on the top side, and I didn't know anything. I knew it, we'd been hit, but I didn't know how much the damage was. But they killed everyone in the turret and a lot of repair party down below there. And
this is your ship? These were your shipmates that were killed?
I was on to Houston, at that time. But anyway, we had several running battles at sea, and we took several air raids. And at one time, we took three ships loaded of troops from Darwin, Australia to Timor. That's an island in Indonesia. And we went under an air raid that day, and had one man killed. The bomb come out on an angle. The ship on the transport went on an angle. And this guy took a big piece of shrapnel in his stomach and killed him. Well, we brought him over to our ship because they didn't have a doctor. But anyway, so we turned around. We found out that Timor had already been captured by the Japs. So we turned troops around and went back to Darwin. Well, anyway, we pulled into Darwin, and them guys, we let them get ahead of us. Because see, while we was being under raid, we would zigzag amongst those transport to draw the fire off of them, see, and onto us. Well, anyway, they lined up, and when we went by all them ships, you would never heard a louder bunch of men waving and hollering and waving at us, for doing what we did. But I get so wound up with some of this stuff. But you see, when we were captured, we were on Java. That's where they took us.
And that was in February of 1944 when you were taken, is that right?
That was in March. When we were leaving the island, we shot up all our ammunition. We couldn't get food or anything hardly. And so we was headed toward Australia to get off the north side of Java. See, it runs east and west. And we had word there was nothing in the straits for 400 miles. Well, we got through that night, and it was everything was there. They'd make a landing on the island, and all the fighting ships were there, and a couple of aircraft carriers and everything. And anyway, see what I mean? Anyway, we took four torpedoes before we went down. And so then I jumped in the water. See, the ship was still moving and the screws were still turning. They gave two abandoned ship orders. And I didn't jump off the first time because I remembered I had a little job to do with a recovery box, first aid thing, box I was supposed to throw over. Well, I went back up above there to get it. And then I went down, went off. But at that time, the ship was dead in the water. And so I know damn well that a lot of men got cut up in them screws because hell, it was as high as this room, four of them on the stern of that ship.
So I understand from jumping off the ship, ship is where they were killed by just the impact of the water?
No,
hitting,
but them screws are turning.
The propellers on the
you
boat.
We lost
yeah.
700 men that night. That's a lot of people. But when I went off, the ship was dead in the water. And I figured right then I better get as far away from it as I can because there's a lot of suction. So I took off, and I never did look back, see where that ship was at or what was going or anything. But 11 hours later, the Japs was, this is daylight now. See, this happened about 12:20 at night. And about 11 hours later, the Japs were still running back and forth with supplies on landing on the island. They went by me one time, two guys standing on the bow of that boat. Had rifles on me. I thought, well, this is it. So anyway, they went on by, and then they turned around and come back. Well, when they come back, they throwed me a rope. I'd been up all that day and all that night and then swimming the rest of the night. I'd wore out. I'd have grabbed anything. But anyhow, I got aboard the ship. And in the meantime, they had already had three or four men in the bottom of that ship, or boat, rather. Anyway, I got on there, and I didn't want to. I had a life jacket on, but I thought, well, hell, I ain't going to get any use out of this life jacket. So I took it off toward the water. Phew! That thing sunk. So who was holding up who? Yeah, that life jacket was soaked up. But see, at that time, they didn't have May West. The Air Force did, but we didn't. They were made out of Kapox. And when it got soaked, it was solid. But anyway, it sunk. But then we were put on the island there, and they had about 21 of us in one bunch there. And they had a Jap officer there who spoke good English. And he said, I have some questions I want to ask you people. He had one chief with us. And he said, I know what you're lying. If you're lying, if you are, you're dead. And he had his 45 in his hand. Because at that time, we didn't know what the kind of people they were. Anyway, we got through that all right. And then, but then, well, this is, I could talk for the rest of the day. But they, see the ship that they had ponies on, they was primitive with a lot of their stuff. And they had ponies to pull these carts of ammunition. Well, we sunk the ship that had the ponies. So there we were, the ponies. And for 5 days, we pulled those carts. No water, no food. The only food we got was what they had left over. You know, a bowl of rice or whatever it was. Anyway.
How much weight did you lose during that time?
Well, I didn't lose too much right at that time. Where I really lost the weight was when I was in the jungle in Burma. See, I put 18 months in that jungle building on that railroad. When I come out, I weighed 93 pounds. Take 100 pounds off me. See what it looked like. I got some pictures in that catalog there of what them guys looked like. But see, we were taking on Java. And then from there, we went to Singapore. And then from Singapore, we went north, part of the way up Malaya on a train. And then they put us on a ship. Okay, between where we was put on the ship in Moulmein, Burma, there was two ships. One of them loaded with Australians and Americans. It was in the lead, and the rear ship was loaded with Dutch, Japs, and railroad equipment. Here come three B-17 bombers over about middle of the afternoon, dropped their bombs, and that Dutch ship, the second ship, in minutes it was gone. I mean, it was all lost. So they went out again, and they come around and made a pass at us, but they dropped their bombs just a little bit too late, and they hit the lifeboat laying on the side. Well, in the meantime, they screaming and hollering, everybody get below deck because they didn't want to see a white man on that ship. So anyway, I laid down on the deck there. The wall was about this high in down that hole, and that's where I was laying when that bomb hit. That's where I took shrapnel in my leg. But anyway, nothing serious. I come out of it all right. But anyway, but they lost that whole troop, that load of ship of men, plus a lot of their own people. But then we landed in Moulmein, Burma. And from there on, we worked on that railroad, building across Burma, Bangkok, Siam. And it was 18 months. The British said it couldn't be done. And the biggest tool we had was a pick and shovel and a broad axe. That's how that railroad was built. They had a four-man crew, and they gave them so much dirt to move a day, and they better moved it, because otherwise they'd give you more the next day. We built all the bridges, cut all the railroad ties, and then everything built on that railroad, and no timber of any kind was ever treated wood. So you know in 2 years it'd be rotten. Well, that was good for them, for us anyway. But anyway, we built the bridges, we built scaffolds, we drove the piling. The biggest thing we had to handle the timber out of the woods was elephants. They would drag the timber down to where we use it, and that's where we worked on to build a bridge. I got pictures to show you how that was done. In Burma itself, I mean, where we was working, there was no medicine whatsoever. And that's where we buried 65 of our sailors in that jungle. And it wasn't a day hardly went by. What we'd carry them across the ditch, and one time, one guy had pretty good hold on, you know. I mean, he had beriberi, but you swell up, your skin swells up with water. Anyway, he died. And we carried him there across this ditch and across the tracks and into the cemetery up there. Well, he busted open on the way down. I capron, oh God, but it was rotten. But I used to carry him out in the sun. I washed his clothes for him, and he had lice. And I boiled his clothes, and finally he didn't make it. But he swallowed so much fluid in him, he choked to death. But we buried a lot of them like that. Dysentery, ulcers. I seen guys' whole legs are bare bone, but the ulcers eat them. Well, I had sea ulcers on my leg, and I won't tell you what I did for them, but it cured them. I urinated on my leg whenever every morning I'd do that. And I kept telling these guys, damn, we get a sore starter, do it. But they wouldn't listen to me. Hell, I ain't going to do that on myself. Well, I did it. And anyway, I'm still here for a lot of reasons.